Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here this Thursday out of the SCC studios in White Bear Lake. We're live. It is also a call-in show, so call in with your comments and questions. We're glad to hear what you have to say or questions you might have to ask. And we got a number of things to discuss today. First of all, what's happening in the city of Grant recently regarding a special meeting and how three of the city council members didn't show up for that, therefore a quorum didn't take place. And the reason I'm talking about this is, you know, not about the city of Grant, although people in Grant, this is important for you. This is about government, and it applies to every local government and the shenanigans that can take place. And then how government officials think they can just do whatever they want, harass people, and get away with it. Our Constitution, and this is going to be a theme tonight, I think, now that I think about it, our Constitution was established to protect the citizen from the government. It was to put restrictions on the government. But we're living in an age today where the government is using the Constitution to put restrictions on people. And there are restrictions on people. So the main topic tonight is going to be about cameras in the courtroom. And why should there be cameras in the courtroom? And why should these trials be public? Is to protect the person charged from the government, from false accusations, from false testimony, from bad behavior from the court, so people can see and learn what's going on. So an individual can be protected from bad government. Well, with that, another city, not only the courts don't want you to videotape during trials, criminal or civil, although they have exceptions, St. Paul Public Schools don't want you to see an open public meeting. They don't want you to see that. They don't want that to be filmed. And that is, that's weird. That's really, really weird. And this is not something that I haven't had to deal with before. Dealt with it not the Supreme Court, but the Supreme Court issue orders for the court to do certain findings on various issues, like the rules, like family law issues, how the court should behave, various things. And they have hearings, public hearings, no votes taken, or there could be a vote. But it's a public hearing, it's a discussion, it's to determine a direction or maybe down the road, but not at that particular meeting. Those get to be filmed. But somehow St. Paul Public Schools think they're special, and that doesn't have to happen there. Well, and then we're also going to talk about Maplewood, who really has cameras and has citizens come and speak, but they don't like it. And so they'll play all their games, as well as St. Paul Public Schools, to intimidate you. They'll walk out of the meeting. You know, they just don't care. And so our, you know, Kathleen Juneman is just really good at this. Probably about as arrogant a person, self-righteous person you can meet. And it's too bad. She doesn't have to do it. She's elected. She doesn't have to be this way. But that's the way she chooses to be. And she doesn't have a servant's heart of serving the people. And the first thing you have to be able to do as a servant is to be able to listen. But if you're not in the room because you don't like who's there and you walk out, that's a bad deal. Also, we're going to have a quick note on a federal court judge who had a complaint filed. An individual found out about a conversation between a federal court judge and an attorney, and so that individual sent a complaint to the Office of Lawyers Professional Responsibility Board against that lawyer. And it's interesting to see the interaction there. I think you'll find it fascinating. Okay. Live call and show, 651-747-3838. Make sure the phone is set to receive a call. Forgot to check on that. And if you want to watch past shows, youtube.com, SpeechlessMN, or Speechless, or you can email me at SpeechlessMN@gmail.com. Couple of announcements here. The big thing next Thursday, I think this is important. If you're a man or a wife, or if you care about men or your sons, there's a Ramsey County League of Local Governments meeting about new challenges in policing. It's Thursday, September 24th. There's two aspects to this time period. 6 to 6:50 is a tour of the Maplewood Police Station, the new police station expansion. And from 7 to 8:30 is a program. They're going to discuss two issues: how technology advances have changed crime and crime detection. And then the one I'm really interested in, of course, that's important. Other people may have see that as being very important. So go. Domestic incidents, today's reality. Men as victims of abuse. This will be part of the discussion. And my understanding is that, well, Karen Olson, manager of legal services from Tubman Family Crisis and Support Services, will be making a presentation during this time, but my understanding is this is going to be more of an open discussion. People who come will be able to talk, ask questions, make comments, similar to this show. You can call in with comments or questions. We are on a time limit here. We only got an hour. But the impact on family and family dynamics, what's really going on in domestic violence today? And I think that will be fascinating. I will try to make a few comments, make sure some facts get out there. Those facts, as I've said over and over on this show, will change the dynamic of the discussion of domestic violence and what women have to do to prevent domestic violence and what men have to do. But if you understand these facts, it's a game changer. I think we would dramatically see domestic violence go down. Hey, in light of that, I was at another thing. There's a movie. I went to a movie today called War Room. Fantastic movie. Takes probably a little bit, you know. Hey, for short attention spans, takes about 5-10 minutes to get into the movie, you know. But man, oh man, great dialogue, great movie, great interactions. I think the actors did a super job. But it is a movie with a spiritual message. And I think it's essential that in light of domestic violence, that movie will play a key part in limiting domestic violence because of the spiritual nature and the recognition that both parties deal with their own depravity, their own ugliness, their own behaviors. And that will be fantastic for that, to help end domestic violence. You go to that meeting Thursday night, go out and see the movie War Room, you got an answer, okay? You have an answer. All right. Okay, let's first go with the city of Grant. Just a bizarre thing that took place, and I forgot to turn my phone off. You know, special meetings are called and cities do certain things for whatever reason, but City of Grant had you have to put legal notices in your newspaper, and they had one that cost about $7,000 a year or a time, and there's another one in the area, $2,200. I think they're pursuing that one. That would be the cost. And well, of course, it depends on your amount of ink space you're taking. But the city grant this year, three of the city council members, except for Lauren Cedarstrom and Larry Lanoue, they voted to go to the highest, most expensive publisher of the legal notices. So instead of something being $2,200 or $7,400, it is $34,000 to print this legal notice that's coming up, which is for their charter. And so there was a special meeting called, which only takes two of the city council members, to have a change who legal notices go through. So they can save the city, you know, anywhere from $31,000 to $37,000. But three of the city council members didn't show up. Now, what those city council members don't realize is there are consequences for not showing up. And you have to have an excused absence. If you don't have an excused absence, then you can be held liable, is my understanding. But it's just really bad behavior. Why not address the issue about changing the legal notices? You can go and say no. Well, in effect, they have said no by not showing up. We're not going to do it. So they're, you know, supposedly they're telling the city we are conservative people, which they're not, not by their behavior. And then they're charging the city all this money. The legal fees are out the roof. Because of their behaviors, not knowing Robert's Rules of Order, not knowing how to do a consent agenda, a lot of issues on their plate. So I just wanted to show you that a special meeting was called, and here's the first video where Larry Lanoue is calling the meeting to order because the mayor wasn't there. So let's see that.
Special meeting. As you can see behind us here, there's a special meeting. It's the second time they've called one, and they refuse to appear at any special meeting called by other councilmen.
Where are we at? The Wheelander?
We're at the Wheelander Schoolhouse, the City of Grant Town Hall today. And today we have a 6:30 special meeting, and I'll just give you the agenda for tonight, and it's a...
Larry, before, I want to interrupt you here. Let's officially put down the time. I got 6:37.
Okay, it's 6:37.
This is official.
This is an official meeting here. The city administrator has refused to show up. The council majority has refused to show up.
The doors are locked.
We're left standing in the rain. That shows how much they care for citizens. And so I'm just going to read the agenda for tonight. The first thing is a call to order. And so I'm calling the meeting to order at 6:37. The next thing is the Pledge of Allegiance, and we'll all say the Pledge of Allegiance. All right. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and justice for all.
Except for two council members.
And now I'm going to ask for approval of the regular agenda. And I got a motion to approve the regular agenda.
I second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Citizens say aye.
Okay, now it's time for public input. Anybody's welcome to have public input at our city council meetings here. So anybody want to stop the public comment?
All right. Well, and Nathan, you can get rid of the next video. We don't need to go there. You know, they just didn't show up. It's a fiasco over there, and that mayor and his two cohorts, Mayor Tom Carr and Jeff Huber and Tina Loben, city council members, they do not know what they're doing, and it's going to cost the city of Grant tons and tons of money, and it's just too bad. They just don't have to be that way. Okay, another form of violence when rules are established and you don't follow them. All right, then let's go down to the St. Paul Public Schools. And Bob Zick from Inside Insight and myself wanted to go down and film public comment for St. Paul Public Schools for the board meeting, and we can. You know, the city doesn't contest that. So you know, Tuesday morning, I called up to go sign up to speak. I wanted to speak too, and found out while I was looking at the calendar, that's what happened, and no school board meeting. I noticed it was on the 22nd. So I looked on there, there's a meeting for some parents association, no other meeting. Well, I get a call from somebody else, and they tell me, well, there is a meeting. I says, there's no meeting, there's nothing on the calendar. Well, check the calendar. Why don't you call down, find if there's a meeting. And so I did call down, and there was a meeting at 5 o'clock. And it's some kind of equity meeting. Board improvement, skills, you know, how to get along, you know, how to draw a consensus. In other words, it was a backdoor way of making policy. And I was really, really, you know, we were told, and you're going to see the video, we were told, oh, you can't videotape this. Well, first of all, it's open to the public, but there's no, it's not on the calendar. You don't know, and nobody would know that it's on the calendar. That's just wrong. It's got to be an open meeting violation in my book, and I would venture to say that it is. So we went down there with a camera to film, and they wouldn't let us film it. So here's the conversation that we had in filming it. This is the first video. Lasts about 3.5 minutes. Yeah, Marilyn.
Have a good night. When are you going home?
At 5. Question, do you know how many board meetings?
They usually, it's like Tuesday. Is it the big board
no,
meeting?
No, that's next week.
So the cabinet of the board? It's probably on the 5th floor.
No, it's a...
I don't know what it's called.
Yes, right here.
So it's a workshop type thing or something. It's open to the public.
Oh, it is. Okay, let me go find out where it is.
Oh, here
it is. Did you find it, Kim?
Harry.
No, not yet.
They said, you're up on quiet?
Yes, but,
hey.
Just so you know, I have a... Are you?
Yep, I will be here as well.
Okay.
You well.
Yep.
They're up in the
cafeteria.
Well, the room that they have, they use the mini of the board. Sorry.
So on the 5th floor.
Yeah.
And do you know if you have access up there?
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Toya.
I'm the assistant director of the communications
office. Oh, okay.
Hi. Good. I see you before. I opened the mess.
That's from you.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Videotaping and recording is not allowed tonight. This was it. It's not.
Yeah.
Videotaping is not allowed tonight.
Okay. Any reason why?
Because the board can decide whether or not.
It's a public meeting.
It's a training session.
That doesn't matter. It's still open to the public. The whole board.
Certainly, it's open to the public. Videotaping
right.
is not allowed.
And if it's open to the public, that's allowed.
No, it's not.
Why?
Absolutely.
Why do you say that?
Because the board has decided that it's not
the board,
allowed.
The board does
based
not.
On advice from our legal counsel.
Okay, well, what did they say? Why did they say?
It's within the board's right to determine whether or not videotaping can happen during a professional development training, and they've decided that that's not going to happen tonight. But you're welcome to sit in there, you just can't record.
But it's a meeting that is open to the public.
It is open to the public, but you're not allowed to videotape.
See, that's the problem. If it's open to the public, that camera's allowed.
It's not allowed according to our legal department and
well,
the board's
I mean,
decision.
Well, I mean, she's just wrong. She's just wrong. That, you know, that's an internal decision that we don't want the camera in there. We want a camera there.
Yeah, you're fine. I mean, if you want to go up, you can talk to the board chair, but she just left my office. We just discussed it, and it's within their right to determine whether or not.
Well, you're saying it's within their rights. I'm saying it's not within their rights.
Based on our legal counsel, it's within their rights to make that determination.
Based on having done this for 28 years, if it's a public meeting that's open to the public, the camera's allowed. You cannot deny the camera unless
the board has that right, sir. If you'd like me to walk upstairs with you to talk to Chair Dorn, I certainly will.
I absolutely would.
Okay. I just was wondering for what reason they have that right. Why do they have that right? Because if it's
an open
meeting, it's public official.
Let me just grab my phone.
Yeah, fun conversation there. Of course, they never, you know, they made statement claims, and we made some too. We're resting on the Constitution, the freedom of the press, and it's a government meeting. You get to record them, especially if you have a quorum, and they had a quorum. Of course, we didn't know at that time whether they would have a quorum or not, and that could have prevented us from not filming, except that it was an official meeting, it was at taxpayers' expense, and it was open to the public. So the next part of the video is us having a further discussion up there. So let's show the next video, and this is us talking with the chair of the St. Paul School Board, Mary Dorn.
Hello, this gentleman would like to speak to you, Chair Dorn.
All right, this meeting's open to the public, correct?
It's an open meeting, correct.
Okay, and if it's an open meeting, and the public can be there, the camera can be there.
That is up to the board.
No, it's not.
It is up to the board, sir.
Why is that?
No, Mary, why?
We have already checked on that, sir.
You checked with your legal counsel here, right? And when we talked to her today, and we recorded that conversation, she did not know where the issue is, what the correct position is on that issue. She's just shooting from her hip. And so an internal person says, no, we can close it. But that's not true. That is absolutely not true. If the public can
Bob,
be...
Bob, I'm going by what the board has directed me, and the board has said... The board has said that they... That this is professional development, and professional development has never been taped.
That doesn't mean
because we have
sensitive
information that sometimes we show. Sometimes during our training sessions, we show students, and that's data privacy. So that's again another reason why we don't have that, and it's never we've never had this. We've never had trouble with anybody accepting that fact. We are not making any decisions based on this. On the district, we're not doing any policy writing. This is professional growth, period.
Well,
like every professional and business does. That's
simply
all we're doing.
Mary, down the road, what you're going to absorb tonight is going to be used for your decision making.
No.
That's going to be, well then why do it? If there's no value to it in your decision making process, there would be no reason to do this. And so I can be sensitive to the part about if there's students presented visually, that's something that we cannot film. But we don't know that prior to, and at that point in time, I trust my cameraman to shut the camera off.
And Bob, I'm going by a precedence that's already been established. This is not me making up.
Well, this has been established today because what I heard is nobody's ever requested this before. So this is uncharted territory for the board.
And you've heard this from who said that? It's never been.
Well, as I explained downstairs, after consulting with Nancy Cameron, who you say you've recorded, somebody's recorded.
Absolutely.
She told the board that it was their decision to decide whether or not this would be disruptive. And get in the way of their training, and they collectively decided that it would be. So they've decided today, since that call, that videotaping isn't allowed
and audio.
That's prior constraint. That prior.
I don't know anything about that. I'm just relaying the message.
You can't say, well, a riot could break out, so therefore we're gonna, you know, keep the public.
Well, the board has decided that videotaping and audio taping isn't allowed. And I share that with you downstairs. I brought you here to talk with the director,
I'm just relaying the message.
This flies right in the face of transparency. Keith Hardy's Sunday article in the paper. The board wants to be transparent, transparent, transparent. There's transparency right there. That's transparency. And so the citizens, if there's things that the citizens should know that the board is being taught that will influence their decision making, the citizens have a right to know that, hear that, see that.
Bob, I'm going to say it again. We're not allowing taping or audio in during professional development.
Why?
I don't know how much clearer
Mary,
I can make this.
Why would audio?
This is. I am just the messenger on the chair. I am telling you what this board has decided. This is not me making this decision on my own. I'm telling you that.
I want to address the whole board.
The whole board is not coming tonight.
I think
we'll barely have quorum.
Well, if it's a quorum, it's a meeting.
Yes. I don't even know if we'll have quorum.
And if you don't have a quorum, it's not a meeting. If there's no quorum there,
and actually,
that
I'm not going to allow you to talk to the board because this is not open to people to come and discuss. This is our professional development. This is not public comment time. This is not time for you to come and want to voice your displeasure on this.
No,
I'm sorry, Bob,
Mary,
but it's not going
to
happen.
I did not look at this as something that I was going to address anything. I was there to observe and gather information. That's all. I am not part of this. I'm just an observer for the press, for the cable show.
You are free to sit there and watch, but you cannot videotape and you cannot audio tape.
But here
that's Bob, you can go in there. You just can't have those two things. And the minute those things are pulled out, you will be asked to leave.
Here's the problem with that. Here's the problem. Then we get into the situation where he said, she said, oh, we didn't say that, but that's not the way we said it. No, that's why we have this.
Bob, this is our professional development. This is not...
How many professional developments do you think I've sat in? I've sat in all kinds of them, not just
here. And the media comes and
does
this? Yes,
and we bring a camera there.
But I got
there.
4 minutes and I need to prep for this professional development.
Go ahead.
So thank you.
Go ahead.
All right. Bob did a great job there. And St. Paul School Board, you're just wrong. But we were later threatened that if we were to come in with the camera, we would be escorted out of the building. And then I asked, well, what happens? I got this on tape, but I'm not going to show you that part. I said, well, what happens if I don't leave? Well, they said, you're going to be escorted out. Of course, escorted out is by police. And then they also said, well, we're going to... we just might not have the meeting or hold it someplace else. Well, you know, you can't do that. They can cancel the meeting. Anybody can do a motion to adjourn or whatever. That's fine. But they can't meet in a quorum size. And they had a quorum there. They had four for most of it and five for half of it. Four for all of it, five for half of it. But then they played games. There was a fight that broke out. Two of the city council members started yelling and screaming at each other, and oh, wait a minute, you don't know whether that happened or not because you can't see it, do you? You just got to take my word for it. Well, it didn't happen. But you see how somebody can do that and see the importance of videotape is that then you can decide what took place and what happened from the angle of the camera that was there. Yeah, sure, things can be from off the side and you don't know what happened off the side, but you do have a perspective going on there. And, well, we got a caller coming in here, but everything that's coming out, you saw the video there, you can make your judgments on that, but the things I'm telling you that happened in that meeting, I'm the filter. Not you, not... You know, I'm the filter. Camera, you don't see it from the camera. So it's just going to be my word against whoever else's word out there. Why not have a camera? people can see it. All right, we got a caller on the line. Caller, do you have a comment or question?
Comment and question.
All right, thank you.
Rich Neumeister.
Hi, Rich. Thanks for calling.
All right, so let's go with a couple things here. First of all, did they admit that it was a open meeting under Chapter 13D, the open meeting law?
They did not admit any statute.
Okay.
They admitted it was an open meeting.
Okay, so, I mean, and just in general,
yeah.
I contend it is a meeting under Chapter 13D, the law, that regulates open meeting laws for public bodies like the school board.
Right.
Now, the issue is was there any, you know, I don't know about the notice and any of that kind of thing. And just like with any, when there's a gathering of four or more or a quorum, and the expectation is, just like a retreat, you know, like North St. Paul and Maplewood City Council, they have those retreats.
Which are personal development things.
Right, and they also do get notice.
Right.
So the issue is to see whether or not there was a notice. And I don't know that. Then the other thing comes into play. I'm just giving you my two cents on.
Sure, you bet.
And while I was watching our program, I was trying to do a real quick search with terms and all that, and I didn't come up with anything real quick. But as you know, iPad does opinions on open meeting. Whether or not they have had an opinion on this particular kind of situation,
all right.
I don't know. You may want to look at that.
Sure.
And also, you may want to ask for an opinion.
Yeah.
Because you know, you can submit evidence here, what your tape does. As you know, for opinions on open meeting, you got to pay $200. But for data practices, it's public, it's free. But that's part of the thing. But maybe they can tell you, maybe there was some opinion that's been done before in the past.
Okay.
The third thing is that I didn't check the statute real quick, but generally most meetings are tape recorded. And whether or not this one was done or not, I do not know. Again, I haven't looked at the statute in a while, but I do remember that there is a requirement that meetings are to be taped except for attorney-client, you know, when the lawyers meet.
Right.
And I don't know if this comes under this or not. And the other question, this is more of a personal thing, because I have had some concerns how the school attorneys historically have interpreted law. Yeah. They, for Superintendent Silva and others, you know, trying to keep information away from the public and all that. And Mr. Lala left. So I'm wondering who this attorney is, maybe trained just like, you know, take it to the max. In other words, take the interpretation of the law to the most thinnest kind of situation.
In benefit of the government.
Yes. And so, I mean, I think there's a lot of legitimate questions. I also give my compliments to you and to Bob, just keeping your cool. That's the important thing. Because they're the ones, I mean, you can already tell by, I forget her name, the woman you were talking to.
Well, the first one or the last one, Mary Dorn, the chairman of the...
No, the person who was sort of like the filter.
Yeah, I forgot her name. Sorry.
But the bottom line is, you know, she was just delivering the message.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And so it's good, and it's important that, so I just give you kudos to that, because a lot of times people go over at the messenger when you shouldn't.
Right. Oh, exactly. And that's how we took it, you know.
Well, anyways, my educated guess is you can record anything you want, you know, at an open meeting. If you want to get down to the technical kind of level, as you know, we're a one party consent state.
Right. I knew. Yeah.
So if you wanted to go into a meeting with a pocket recorder, you could have done that too.
Yeah.
So I mean, I laid out some scenarios for you to, you know, do a little bit of further checking on, and I would encourage you to do so.
All right. Thank you, Rich. I appreciate that. Very, very good comments. They do have a committee of the board, which the whole board meets together. I don't know if they record that. It is not played on their cable channel, which the board meeting is played. There is a place for the press, and the press can videotape the committee of the board. And that's where we were in that room, but it wasn't a committee of the board meeting. Maplewood has these development meetings, personal development. And here are some of the questions that were asked, which I, you know, good questions, you know, but, you know, doing it for, you know, in a quorum situation. What times do you feel you have had successful leadership, or felt successful as a leader? And so they were in groups of two, and there's six people there, two administrator, four city council. And so in answering those questions, they got up and walked around the room, you know, so that we wouldn't see you're here, or there'd be too many to follow around. And we didn't care. We wanted to film the thing. How did you find that this success furthered your goal of racial equity? So they're talking policy. They have a goal of racial equity. Not judging the racial equity part, I'm talking about there was a specific question relating to policy there. That's an open meeting. This is the school board's goal, racial equity. They're talking policy. It gets to be filmed. Now, later on, the question came, think of the times you have been challenged to be an effective board member. Well, they broke down into groups of three and four, with having three board members in one group and two in the other. So again, you didn't, all of a sudden there wasn't that quorum there, but they never adjourned the meeting, so the quorum's still there. But then they went to other rooms, you know. And, you know, it's just a game they play. They know how to play it. We know they're playing the game, but they're wrong. They will be held accountable on this, and they will learn from it. You know, that's just what you have to do to have an open meeting. The statement that got me at the end of all this was by Ann Carroll. And she walked back into the room. They didn't really close the meeting. It was just, all right, we're done. Not everybody was there. Some couple left just a little before. Ann Carroll walked into the room and said, "We came up with something substantive." All right, what does that mean? Was that policy related? If you're coming up with something substantive, it's about policy, it's about the direction of the school board, it's about what they're going to do. It's a, you know, there's our government hiding in secret. All right, man, we're running out. So much to go through. I'm not going to get through this judicial stuff, but we can save it for a later date, maybe. I have to cover this Maplewood stuff. What city council meeting. So I spoke down there, had a number of concerns. During the meeting, I switched up the order of what I was going to say. The main thing I saved to the last, and of course I was out of time. Kind of like what I do on this show. Save the main thing for last and then run out of time and don't talk about the main thing. That's called real good preparation there. So we're going to show little clips here, but just see how you're treated as a citizen of Maplewood. And of course, because you have a cable TV show, they think they can treat you worse or as bad as they treat anybody else. Okay? And it's, they just don't like, you know, iron sharpens iron. Having a debate or having five people with the same ideas doesn't encourage debate or thought process or ingenuity, okay? And sometimes all that ingenuity is on these shows, these local cable TV shows that are trying to get the city council to actually think and think about what really matters. And because what are the real issues going on? You don't know all the time what the real issues are. Most of them relate to money, who's going to get paid, you know. And even though we're a green city, how can we not be a green city and still say that we are? And that's coming up. All right. So here's the first video where I get announced that I'm going to speak. Listen to what Councilmember Kathleen Judeman says. Okay, go.
God.
Well, thank you, Kathleen Judeman. You know what? I'm not God. She may think I am. I'm not. I just want to make that straight because I won't make her bow to me or whatever. Of course, she wouldn't anyway. She probably doesn't even bow to God. But if she thinks I'm God, that's a problem right there with Kathleen Judeman, because that's ridiculous. So that's part of her, maybe her dementia. Just having a little fun there. Of course, she doesn't think I'm God. But all right, now let's go to the next clip. And who's there to listen to the citizen? It's your job. Put it on the agenda. Who's there to listen? Let's play that.
God. Jim Kinley.
Notice the mayor's seat there, right in the middle? That empty, well, there's two of them now, but right in the middle, the mayor's not there. Huh, what happened to the mayor? People from the community coming to speak and gone. All right, let's show the next video, and we'll see Kathleen Judeman actually do her exit out of the building. You know, she doesn't want to hear what God has to say.
Jim Kinley.
Get your clock set.
Mayor, council members. Oh, mayor's not here. Oh, council members leaving.
Name and your address.
All right, there they go. You know, just rude, rude as can be, but that's Kathleen Judeman in her self-righteousness. You're a servant, you know, just 6 minutes of your time. Listen to the people from the community speak about concerns that are important to them. And I have some real issues here. Authentic conversation. And since you're limited to 3 minutes, how can you have this authentic conversation? That's why we expand it down the road. Okay, let's play the next video clip.
State your address.
I am Bob Zick, broadcasting out of Suburban Cable Commission. 2460 East County Road F, White Bear Avenue, Minnesota. The reason I don't give my home address, Mayor, is because you know I bring a lot of controversial issues forward, and it's a safety issue. Now, if we really want to talk about addresses, let's have some of the addresses of people sitting around here give their address. The city council or the city manager, Matamidi, the police chief, Mendota Heights, our city attorney, I think Oakdale, where is it? I mean, it would be nice if these people would give their, it'd be nice if Mary Abrams would give her phone number and not use the city's phone number. So we will put this into the record.
All right. This whole address, Bob makes an excellent point there. You see, this is the part. This is the government thinking you're the servant. But our laws are that the government's the servant. You treat us with respect. You treat the people with respect. You have limits put on you. Okay, it's just this backwards thinking that is destroying our country. And these, and I would say all of them on that Maplewood Community Center, have that backwards thinking and are destroying the Maplewood community as it is. Now, the next video, Nathan, I want you to show is the one that says no on it. I don't know if that's the next one up, but I want the no to be shown. Because what is happening is Maplewood is trying to constrict what the citizen can say and forcing them to do things they don't have to do, like give your address. You don't have to do that. There's no law that's required. They may have that in the rules. You don't have to do it anyway because there's no requirement constitutionally. You get to say what you want to say, and it takes away time from what you say, the time limit they set on you. So I was watching Bob speak, and you're going to notice in the video, I'm looking at the chair, and I see her, you won't see it, but I see her shaking her head like this. I go, why is she doing that? Who's she talking to? And I'm kind of looking, and then all out of the corner of my eye, I see Karen Haig, go like this across her neck to shut the mic off because Bob wasn't giving his address. And I go, who's she doing that symbol to? Well, she was looking at the city manager. I finally figured that out and then looked back at Karen Haig, and she's still doing this, you know, and then Karen Haig looks at me and has this big smile, and I'm shaking my head going, uh-uh. No, you don't turn off the mic. That's what they were going to do. All right, so let's watch this video, and then you'll see all this happen. All right. So I'm looking there at the city council, city manager. There I see Guilfoyle, then I'm back to the city manager. Then I'm back to Guilfoyle. Oh, here's what's going on, what's going on? You're not going to turn off that mic. You know, there's all this behind the stuff that you don't always see on camera, and that was one of them. Boy, silencing the speech. All right, we have a caller here. Caller, you have a comment or question?
Yeah, I just wanted, this is Rich Neumeister again. I just looked up the statute.
Okay.
And where I was referring to where all meetings must be taped, that's only for closed meetings. Only for closed meetings except for attorney-client privilege.
Okay.
So there may be no requirement. I was just going through some of the things on news and all that, and I saw something with some county that they weren't recording their meetings, some county board. So maybe that's one of, so as you know, sometimes the irony of doing things, you find out things that maybe there ought to be a law that there
right.
should be recordings and
yeah.
stuff like that. So
right.
anyways, I just wanted to clarify because I didn't know for sure, and I referred to that in my last comment.
Okay.
Too.
All right. Thanks, Rich. Yeah, closed meetings. Even though you can't be there, they got a quorum, they still have to be recorded because it's usually attorney client or, you know, the city council needs to talk about negotiations for contracts, and they need to have that privacy in order for leverage for negotiating a price of doing a building or whatever, settling a lawsuit. That needs to be private. But it's recorded, and then after things are done, then you can go and listen to the recording. But, all right. Now, let's go to the next video here. And I think we're going to get into what I wanted to say to Maplewood.
Sell the community center. The drain on our resources. Year after year after year after year, and then 20, as long as it's been in existence. And it would just save us a lot of money. And we don't have to waste our time talking about it here for city council meetings.
Yeah, so much stuff with Maplewood Community Center. And I don't have time to show the video, but that was part of the discussion where Mary Lee Abrams asked Dewey Kaneko, well, I see these expenses, but are there any other expenses that are going to come up for the Maplewood Community Center, such as a roof being replaced or some other aspect that, you know? And Dewey Kaneko gave a non-answer. He just blabbed along. And Mary Lee Abrams accepted that. Now, Mary Lee Abrams promotes herself as a tough negotiator, a tough attorney, expert in negotiations, and of course she's up here at the Cable Commission really ripping into the board and all that kind of stuff, really being aggressive. And she can be a lot nicer. She can have a better behavior. But when it comes to the city of Maplewood and protecting the citizens, she's milquetoast. You know, it's just unbelievable. She just got a whole bunch of smoke blown at her by Dewey Kaneko, and she just accepts it. And it's costing you money. And when it went through the budget and the failure of the Maplewood Community Center to break even year after year after year, and going through our budget, not just the Maplewood Community Center, the reasons of the deficits of our own budget was because the increased debt cost of the Maplewood Community Center, because you got to finance that debt and the expenses involved in replacing the boiler and repainting the walls or repainting the pool, all bunch of stuff like that. That's why I say sell it. Just get rid of it. All right, let's go to the next video there, see what I have to say.
Regarding express transit, I ride the transit system almost every day. Please don't bring anything up the Gateway Trail or Bruce Ventral Trail or whatever trail. Those are beautiful trails. I think we should lose all our steps in the Green City thing if we do that. This makes no sense at all. Light rail is expensive and it's inflexible. I ride the light rail. I mean, if that thing shuts down for whatever reason, you're stranded. Hours. Communication on that is terrible. The bus, you know, next bus that comes along, or they get one out there as soon as they can. The buses is less expensive and it's flexible, and using the highway system or the streets is plenty good enough. To destroy that beautiful bikeway that we have in Maplewood, it's just terrible. Terrible thing to do.
You know, I write down that once in a while, the trails and where they want to turn into either light rail or busway, they're going to have to take out so many trees. We got all these steps for this environmental conscious city, and we're going to be destroying thousands upon thousands of trees. And I remember I was at, they had a little table out there at the Maplewood Transit Center, and talking about the light rail and communicating with people, you know, want a discussion. I mentioned the aspect. That's a beautiful parkway. You're just going to destroy it. There's no way a light rail would work there, and that bikeway would be gone. And they go, or walkway or whatever, and they said, well, we still have to put in a walkway. Okay, we can't take the walkway out. There'd be the light rail and the walkway, which would make it even wider. And if you've seen the Hiawatha line or the line for the Hiawatha line, the blue line, or the green line to St. Paul, you got to have a lot of width. It just destroys so much of our natural beauty. When we got streets, we got ways, it'd be so much more efficient, so much more cost effective if you're going to do an express route to do it the other way. All right, let's go to the next video here. My control person just going to send me a message,
now,
but I know what it is.
Because of lack of time, see, I only got a minute left. I do want to develop further these discussions. So 8 o'clock Thursday night, Channel 15 on Speechless. People can see further discussions here on that show. It's not promoting the show. It's promoting discussion. Mm-hmm. You want to propaganda it any way you want. It's about community involvement and community engagement. It's another form of it. And because we get so little time.
All right. We talked about that, and of course, Mayor Slawick is, yeah, right, sure. We're promoting the show for the purpose of public engagement and having more time on issues and different points of views that they don't want to hear because they only give you 3 minutes. Let's go to the next one. This is the important one.
I would like to talk about the value of life And since this can be taken out of context, I have to wait to the show. But here's what I have to say. It's my life. You are not to take it by inaction or action. I am a standalone individual on my life. Do what you can do to save my life. I have not written anything to the contrary. I don't care what someone else thinks, even though they may be my spouse or my child. Don't listen to them. Listen to me.
Well, I have so much more. I have 2.5 minutes of talk. I don't have enough time on the show. My point of making that was this. With all the Planned Parenthood stuff and the murdering of babies and the fraud and the falsity going on, we've developed a culture that life isn't important. And when Fire Chief Lucan took the word of two people not to save the life of this woman, he had no right or responsibility to not try to save her life. She had no directive that said, don't save my life. But they didn't do anything. Chief Lucan, you should resign or be fired for cause. I'm going to develop that one more next time. It'll be on the top of the list. Also, November 17th, in the appellate courts, cameras in the courtroom, a big hearing. Attorney Michelle McDonald, who ran for the Supreme Court, was denied that constitutional right. And courts are going to have to decide this. I think it's going to be an exciting case. All right, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. Sets on